Anyway, today inshallah guys we will continue inshallah in the chapter number 3. Somebody might wonder where is chapter number 1 and chapter number 2 actually. Chapter number 1 and chapter number 2 are already the review that we conducted last week. And I was trying to be very precise and just to, as the people says, I used to go to the bottom. I give you the cream of the two chapters, okay? There is only one topic left, which is interference and the clearance. And I'm pretty sure that this is not a strange topic. I think it was covered in machine design, in mechanical drawing 2, ME 212. If you remember, there was a topic at the end of the ME 212, which is called clearance and interference connections. But anyway, I'm going to go back to this one later, inshallah, because it's not that important for the for now. Today, inshallah, I'm going to finish up that this session, which is about how to draw the shear force diagram and how to draw the bending moment diagram. Why we did not mention, guys, normal force diagram, although it was there in the mechanics of material. The only reason for not mentioning the normal force diagram, because it's very simple, very trivial. And in most of our application, it's very rare to find a normal force. I mean, the force acting along the center of the shaft, except one case. In one of the types of the gears, when it comes to the gears, inshallah, in machine design 2, there are different types of gears. Only one of them, one of the three components of the reaction, because actually, for example, if you remember that gear that we started our session last time with, we found that there are two reactions, one which is normal going to the center of the gear, and the other one which is tangential. The third type of gears called the bevel gear. And in this kind of gears, you might have a third component acting along the center line or parallel to the center line of the shaft. So to make it short, it's very rare to find a normal force acting in the shaft of any machine. And this is why we are not studying a normal force diagram. We are just focusing on the shear force and the bending moment diagram. And inshallah, during the semester, we will have that odd example to show you if you have a normal force or a force parallel to the center line, what can you do with it, okay? Just for this problem, I think we finished up that problem, and the main points that I need to repeat about this problem, that whenever you see something like this, you have to collect the two forces at the ends of the body, at the middle, by adding them up. And then you add also a torque, and this torque should be equal to the difference between the two forces times the radius of that body, okay? And then you will end up with a simple force acting at the center, taking the same direction of the two tensions on the both sides of the belt, and a torque taking the same direction of the bigger force. And then you will end up with that shape. After having that shape, you will start dividing that shape into two pieces. You will deal with all the forces acting in the XY plane, okay, and come up with everything up to until you reach the bending moment diagram and the shear force diagram. And then you will switch to the ZX plane, and whatever you did in the XY plane, you will repeat it again in ZX plane. And then you come to different location, like the location at point B. You can figure out how to get the total force acting at the moment B by using the square root of the A component in the horizontal direction square plus the component in the vertical direction square. Same story at point C. Okay, what about the moments? Again, if you draw the bending moment diagram, again you will end up with two moment in the x direction or horizontal moment and vertical moment. What can we do to come up with the total moment? Is just to use also the summation of the moment, the horizontal square plus summation of the moment vertical square at both points. And then you end up with collection of numbers, and then you decide which location is more subjected to failure. Then you can start working at this one. What if at the same location I have mix up between maximum moment, assuming that we have maximum moment here, but the total force is not maximum. And when you go to that location, you find that your moment is minimum, but the is not minimum. I mean, the moment here is smaller than the moment there. Okay. But when it comes to the shear force, it's a greater than the shear force there. So in a case like this, you have to, you must study both cases, and then you come up with the unknown dimension, and then you decide which one you will take, which is supposed to be the bigger one. Okay? But let me pay your attention to something, guys. Usually we said it's okay to make our product safe, I have to go with the bigger dimension, but this is not always the case. Yani, for example, if I give you a shaft, okay, and that shaft has a is a solid shaft. When I say word solid, it means, guys, there is no hole inside. يعني معناها مصمت بالعربي. تمام? There is no hole inside. And I told you, make your calculation to come up with the safest diameter of that shaft. You will make your calculation, you will go through all these steps, and then you end up by calculating D. And then let's assume that your diameter, the diameter that you calculated, let me do something here at the right side. Just one moment, guys. Okay. Let me take this, get benefit from these two sides of the monitor. Okay, so I'm going to assume that you ended up by calculating your D, and then you find that your diameter is 20.123, whatever. Okay, let's say your units also are in millimeter. So what do you suggest, guys? You have to come up, first of all, in most of the cases, we have to come up with a diameter in terms of round figures. I mean, arqam sahiha. Okay? So it's better to claim this is the safe diameter that you have to calculate. Is it better to say my diameter is 20, or it's better to say my diameter is 21? Which one you recommend? I told you, once you finish your calculation, you'll say it's okay. This is my maximum A. This is the maximum diameter. This is the minimum diameter allowed, such that this mechanical member will not fail. But we have another step. This number that you calculated, it should be the final form of that number should be in around the figure. I mean raqam sahih, tamam? 20, 21, 22, 19. So which one you recommend here, guys? Is it better to make a mathematical approximation and then you end up that your diameter is 20, or it should be 21?
21.
Okay, safer. You know the reason behind 21 from the mechanics of material. Am I right or wrong?
Yes.
To be safe, doctor.
To be safer.
Yes, sir. Okay, let me repeat it again, guys. See, if you catch exactly what I mentioned, this is supposed to be your answer without studying the mechanics of material. I exactly said the following. This is the minimum allowed diameter, such that your mechanical member will not fail. When you say minimum allowed diameter, means what? If you get below that number with a micron, not 1 millimeter, if you get below that number with a micron, this means that your shaft will fail. So although the mathematical approximation, it tells me that this number should be approximated to 20, but I'm not caring about the mathematical approximation here, guys. I'm just caring about the design approximation. I have to be very conservative, okay? And in this case, you will end up by saying that this one is 21, not 20. You got it? You got this one, guys?
Yes, doctor, I understand.
Okay. So everybody got this one from mechanics of material, okay? But let me tell you the surprise. All of you guys are completely wrong for two things. First of all, how did you guarantee that this 21 millimeter diameter is practically applicable in the market? What do I mean practically applicable in the market? You know that any shaft in any machine should be holded by two bearings, okay? Two bearings. And in this case, before you think about 20 or 21, you have to think about what are the standard diameters of the bearing in the market, assuming that this is a very simple shape of the bearing, guys. You know how the bearing looks like, the roller bearing or ball bearing. Okay? So first of all, before you decide which diameter exactly you have to follow up, you have to go to the market and see what is the nearest diameter of the bearing which exists in the market. So let's assume that for the bearing, I mean, in the bearing, guys, there are a lot of terminologies, but The simplest one is to say this one is called the inner race, inner race. The race here means الحلقة اللي هي circle. Okay, inner race. Okay, I'm sorry for the handwriting. And this one is outer race. Okay, so there are different methods by which you select your bearing, but one of them is the diameter of the inner race. So let's assume that you decide to go to the market and you found that the available dimension for that, there are varieties of course of the ball bearing or roller bearing in the market. But let's say that you have 15 and then you have 20 and then you have 25 and then you have 30 and so on. Okay, I just picked up some numbers around the number that you found from your calculation. So now, do you think that your answer is right based on these standards of the ball bearing in the market, or you have to adjust your decision to match with whatever is available in the market? Yani, for example, guys, if you are going to the market and asking somebody for the size of some screw bolt, he will give you any screw bolt, or the very first thing to ask you about the size. The size of the bolt, we have M10, M12, which is the diameter. Usually, it's called the nominal diameter of that bolt. So there are something in the market, guys, or in the design, is called the standardization. Okay, nobody can do his own business without following the standardization, except in very rare case. If you are a strong country and you have your own plan to build up your own machine, so you have your own standards and you have you standardize everything for yourself, not to follow the regular standard. But this is not our business. So again, guys, I'm going to get back to the question.
Yes, like practically in real life, not theoretically, when solving problems. Is it like, for example, here in the Middle East, not to be case here. Is it possible for me to design a shaft with in this example with 21 and maybe have a contract with some company of steel or something to design this, or it's impractical at least in the Middle East, let's say, for this example?
You mean you come up with your own dimensions and then you go to one of the companies to let's say it in English, to tailor, يعني كأنك بتفصل قميص ومؤاخذة يعني. To tailor a ball bearing for that, is that your question?
Yeah, to design a shaft, maybe as piston manufacturing processing, have 25, for example, shaft, and then order it at some company or a lathe, and to design it at 21 millimeter. Is it possible, at least in the
beginning? No, usually for mechanical components like bearing, it's very expensive, and practically it's not accepted. Nobody will do this because he has to change the whole line of the production for you. You have to adapt yourself to whatever is available in the market. This is from the economic point of view, man. If you are a wealthy man and you have a lot of money and you want to spend it here and there, just give it to me. Okay? You got the point, guys? So I'm going to take you back to my question. After you decide that your diameter to be safe, it should be 21, not 20. But do you think that this is the right answer?
No, it should be.
What is the right answer?
It should be follow the standardized in the for the companies.
Yeah, give me based on that example, what will be your final decision?
25.
Allah ينور عليك. You got this one, guys?
Yes.
So be careful. Whenever you design anything, okay, we have two things to follow. First of all, I have to be conservative. The word conservative means what? When you make the mathematical rounding, don't follow the mathematical rounding, which tells you that this one should be 20. No. All the time you go to the upper ceiling. Okay? Which is 21 in case like this. Not only this, I will see. Maybe the upper ceiling is exactly fitting with the market. Yani maybe the number that you got was 24 point something. And then by default, it would become 25. And in this case, you don't need to go to the other step because 25 is already there in the market. You got my point? Anyway, this is one of the one of the examples, but let me tell you that there is an odd cases for selecting the dimensions. I'm pretty sure that you hear that all the time, make your dimension bigger, okay? Except in only one case, which is, let's assume, guys, that the shaft that you're intending to design is a hollow shaft. Then in this case, we have the outer, and we have also what? We have the inner. Okay, now, be careful from what I'm gonna tell you. Okay, when you select the outer, let's say that you selected the outer according to the standards in the market, okay? According to the standards in the market. And then you decide to also design to select the inner according to standards of the market. And then let's assume that you got something like this. You got 16.204. I'm just picking up any number out of my mind, okay? Now, guys, this is this inner diameter. This is exactly what you got directly from the calculation. So this inner diameter in this case, if you need to give me the exact final answer, what will be the exact final answer, assuming that there was something that will get into that hole, like you can put, for example, power screw or something like this, okay? And this power screw, I mean the standards in the market, is something like this, 10, 15, 16, okay? I'm just picking up some number, okay? And then 17, or let's say 18. Forget about 17. And forget also about 16. It's just 10, 15, 18, and then you jump to 20. Okay? This is like something, you will put it inside that diameter. So now, tell me what will be your selection. It 15. Should be 10, or 15, or 18, or 20?
10, doctor.
I think DI should be 15.
15. Anybody else agree with your colleague, guys?
Yes,
I do.
Because 16 is the maximum diameter, 16.2.
Okay. So no. Just one moment. I'm gonna hear back from you. But let me ask you the question for the other people. Do you all agree, guys, that this number should be 15?
Yes.
Okay. So let's just justify. I need one of you guys who agreed that this one should be 15. Just justify your answer. Give me the reason why you pick up 15.
Because 15 thicker than 18, doctor. Which means safer.
Okay, so you mixed up the answer. Actually, first of all, guys, if you are thinking about mathematical approximation, this number should be 16. Am I right or wrong? I'm just talking about pure mathematical approximation, okay?
Yes, doctor.
And if you are thinking about the way that we used in the case before, this number should be 17. Because we are always looking for a bigger number. But be careful, guys. For the inner dimension, if you decide to go and select the 17, here is exactly what will happen to your material. The material or the thickness of the of the wall of that hollow shaft will become thinner. And the thinner means what? Your shaft will be subjected to the chance for each shaft to fail will be bigger. So when it comes to the inner dimension, I am always looking for what? If this is the case of your shaft?
For smaller.
I mean that whatever you get from the mathematical calculation, it's better to make it to select smaller diameter, smaller dimension. Why? Because the smaller dimension means what? Means bigger, means more material, thicker material, more safe. Okay? Yeah. Not only this. So we can say it's okay, it's 16, but we found that this 16 is not standard. This is why we went to what? With the even smaller, which is 15. Why 15? Because this is the standard. And I cannot I cannot select anything which is not standard. You got the point, guys? This is very important.
Yes, doctor, it's clear.
Alhamdulillah, that's clear. Now let's move on to the This is the end of the problem, and I was already commenting on the problem. Now let's move to another part. In this part, guys, we are trying to put some forms to make your life easy. If you remember, if you need to draw the shear force diagram and the bending moment diagram, what was the first thing that you have to calculate? I'm going to take you back to the last lecture. Remember, guys, that we start from this very general form for the distributed load, and we say it's okay. I see that your dV is the integration of q dx. So if you need to calculate the shear force diagram, you have to say it's okay. I have to come up with the equation of the force in terms of x if it's distributed. Okay, if it's not distributed or concentrated, I'm going to tell you another story now. So just remember, or what you need you to remember from the last lecture, guys, that your v is always equal to the integration of q dx. Okay, guys, and your m is always equal to the integration of a vdx. So far so good. Okay, now let me take you back to this table. This table we call it singularity. Singularity is coming from the word single. Okay, so what do I mean? How can I understand that table? The table tells you the following story. Whenever you have a shaft, let's say, guys, that you have a shaft. Let me draw it somewhere else. I'm sorry. Let's draw it somewhere here. Okay. And it happened that on that shaft, you have one of these four cases listed down here. Either you have a concentrated force, and this concentrated force could be acting downward or acting upward. It doesn't matter, but it's a concentrated force at the end. Or it could be concentrated moment. Okay. And it could be acting in the clockwise or the anti-clockwise direction, or you may have like distributed load in a uniform shape, or you may have a distributed load in a ramp shape. These are most of the cases that you might see when you draw the shear force diagram or the bending moment diagram. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, you are right.
Okay. There are some cases like the distributed load could be combination between like a uniform load and distributed and the ramp load at the same time. And this is another story. Here we are just talking about these very simple shapes. Or in some cases, you might have something like this, that the load distribution is parabolic or polynomial of the n order 3 or 4 or whatever 5. Okay, so whenever you have a case like this or case like this, this is another story which is out of the scope of our business here. Now, you are telling me that this table will make my life easy. How can this table make my life easy? Very simple, guys. First of all, this equation is the equation of Q. In other words, whenever you see concentrated moment, you're going to replace that concentrated moment with this Q of X, which is equal to what? Equal to X minus A. What is A, guys? It is the location at which the moment is acting. You replace it with X minus A raised to the power negative A, negative 2. And here is exactly what will happen. It tells you that whenever your A is any number other than A, then, I'm sorry, whenever your X is any number other than A, then in this case, X minus A raised to that power, which represents QX, will be zero, yes. And exactly, when your X is exactly, it should be exactly equal to A, this means that your Q of X becomes either positive infinity or negative infinity. Actually, I'm not caring here about the value of the QX itself. I'm just caring about what will be next. If you remember, guys, if you need to calculate V, V is equal to what? Q of X dx. You got it? So now, what you're going to do, you will take that A, this equation. But be careful, guys. This equation is assuming that your M, first of all, acting in the clockwise direction, which means that if my case was a M acting in the anti-clockwise direction, then I have to replace the A. I have to add here negative number. Second thing, this equation also is based that the magnitude of your M is unity, 1. Okay? And again, let's say that my M here in this case is equal, for example, to any number, 10 Newton meter. What should we do? Very simple. You will tell, you will do the following. You will say QX is equal to 10 times what? X minus A raised to the negative 2. You got it? And now, guys, if you have a form like this inside the integration, the very first thing to do is to take the constant out of the integration. Am I right or wrong?
It's all right.
And in this case, you will end up that your calculation or the V value will be 10 times the integration of this one. And here, I'm not asking you, I'm not testing you in the math. I'm going to give you the final answer. The final answer for integration of something like this is directly equal to what? X minus A raised to the negative 1. Halas? In other words, guys, if I give you shape like this, let me give you a very simple example. I'm still speaking about the first case, guys, okay? And I told you that somewhere here, there is a moment acting in the anticlockwise direction, and the value of that moment is exactly equal to 12.5 Newton millimeter. So how can I calculate the V at that exact location? You will tell me it's okay. My Q for a case like this should be 12.5 times X minus A raised to the power negative 2. This is a Q of X. And then you will end up that your V is equal to the integration of that number dx. So I'm going to take 12.5 out of the A, out of the integration. Okay? And then you end up that your the integral, I mean the part that will be integrated, it will be x minus a raised to the power negative 2. Okay, let me also specify a. Let's assume that this value is any number, let's say 3. Okay? So in this case, I'm going to replace a with 3, and then dx. Now, guys, what will be the final value of the v? It will be 12. Be careful from what's coming. 12.5. And as I understand from that table, that the integration of that part should be x minus a raised to the negative 1. In another terms, in our case, it will be x minus what? 3. X minus 3 raised to the power negative a. Raised to the power negative 1.
Doctor?
Yes.
Should 12.5 be in the minus sign because it is anticlockwise direction and in the formula it is clockwise direction?
Yes, sir. Thank you. And this was, I was postponing this one until the end. I did not finish it. But anyway, thank you that you are awake. See, guys,
doctor?
First of all, you have to understand that this is your reference direction. Okay? So, then the very first step, forget about how the number will look like. Just first of all, think about the sign. According to this reference direction, this one should be negative. This one should be negative, and that one should be negative, and then you finish up your business this way. Anyway, guys, you end up with a V, which is still function of what? Your V is a function of what, guys? Function of X. Then you can start from X equal to 0, X equal to 1, X equal to 2, and so on until you finish up the V along the whole beam. You see the idea, guys, behind that table?
Yes.
Okay, now, let's have another example. This one is dealing with what? Concentrated what?
Concentrated force.
And then the table tells you right now, once you have a concentrated force of magnitude 1, then you will end up that your Q of X is equal to X minus A raised to the power negative 1. Forget about this whole story. Okay? I'm just caring about that part, which represents what? V. Then your V will be the integration of X minus A raised to the negative 1 dx. So practically speaking, how can I deal with a case like this? Very simple. Let's assume that this is your beam. Let me erase everything here. Alhamdulillah, we have a recording, so it will be there in the recording. Now, guys, let's assume that I'm dealing with a case like this. I have concentrated force acting upward of 30, any number, and away from the left side, a distance equal to 2.5. and then I have another force acting downward, which is equal to 15. And it's away from the left side, a distance equal to 6, for example. Okay. Now, how can I put the value of the V? V is equal, not V, of course. I'm going to think about Q first and then a V. I have Q for this one. And I have Q another Q for that one. Okay. So now I can claim that my Q of X, which is a function that describes the forces regardless if it's concentrated or distributed. Now your Q of X is equal to, let's deal with the first case. First of all, you have to compare the direction of this impulse. They call it impulse, by the way. Sometimes they call it unit impulse. Why it's impulse? Impulse, جماعة معناها نبضة. Because it shows up in a very short time and then it disappears. This is the reason they call it impulse. And I'm sure that you are familiar with this name from the math. Anyway, so you have Q of X. For the first part, I know that my A is equal to 2.5. Okay? And the reference direction is consistent with the reference direction is consistent with my direction, which means the sign is positive. So now I'm gonna start by putting positive 30, and then I'm gonna take that positive 30 and multiply it by what? By this form, which is x minus a. What will be the a for the first case, guys? 2.5, and then you raise it up to the power negative 1. Now let's move to this one. According to the reference direction, this should have negative. And the magnitude is 15. And then you will end up by multiplying x minus, this time a is 6. Equal to what? 6. And then you raise it to the power negative 1. And then after creating this equation, you'll move to the next step, which is v is equal to the integration of all these things. You got it, guys? You know how to deal with a situation like this?
Doctor?
Yes, doctor.
Sir.
Not sure about speaking? The Rida.
Rida, what do you want, Rida?
I'm not sure about the integration. There is something because the integral of x minus a power minus 2 should be minus 1 over x minus
a. Rida, ما تستبقش الأحداث يا Rida. Please. Now, just let's think about how to create the form. Are you okay with creating the form?
Okay. I only have
okay, now, the integration. Just one moment. When it comes to the integration, I will tell you the whole story about the integration. But so far, I just need you to digest how to create the form of the QX. So my question now, is it clear, guys, or not?
Okay.
Yes, okay, it's clear.
Thank you. Now, guys, let's go to a case of a uniformly distributed load. Let's assume that I have a load like this. This is the camera. This is the beam. Okay. And let's assume that our W here in this case is equal to 13 Newton per millimeter. Remember, what did we call this number? We call it a load density when it's distributed load. Okay, guys. So now if I need to create an equation for this one, of course, this is the distance A. Let's assume that this distance is a 5. Okay, and be careful, guys. This form is built up based on that your uniform load will go all the way to the right side. Be careful. This form is based on that your load or uniform load will go all the way to the right side. So what should I do in a case like this? Let's deal with the A. With the regular case, that assuming that my load will go all the way to the right side, how can I deal with this case like this? Very simple. Again, I'm going to say QX is equal to, first of all, this is unit, but the number that I have is how much? 13, okay? And of course, we are assuming in this case that this is the load. It's going downward, and usually the distributed load is represented on the A, on the side, the true side. I mean, if it's positive, I mean, if it's acting from top to bottom, it should be acting at the top. If it's acting from bottom to top, it should be acting downward. Okay? So no need to tell you that this arrowhead is going up or down. So now guys, if you compare this number, that number, then you will end up that your number here is supposed to be positive 13. Okay, now let's move to the next step. How your x will look like? My x will look like this. I mean the form. It will be x minus, what will be your a here in this case, guys? What will be your a here in this case?
5.
Yes, sir. It's 5. And then raised to up to the power a, to the power 0. And here in that situation, you might face a problem with the integration, as Reda asked before. But let me tell you the story. If in case you are dealing with a case like this, okay, just to go and put the final answer. Don't think about the integration. I'm not caring about. I'm not a mathematician, man. I'm just here. I'm practicing what's called the applied mechanics. I go to the final form of the mathematician and just apply it. This does not mean that we are not smart enough. No, we are just saving our time. We're not going to work as mathematician and at the same time designer. Okay, as long as I'm trusting what they did, then it's okay. I'm not gonna discuss it with them. So now guys, if somebody tell me how can I integrate this one, very simple. Don't think about the integration. In case that it will come to the integration, remember that this integration will end up with something like this. And if you are trying to compare it with whatever exists in that singularity table, you will end up that your answer here, I mean, you replace this complete part after the integration with what? X minus 5 raised to the power negative 1. You got my point? You got my point, guys, here in this one?
Positive 1,
positive
doctor.
One, doctor.
Yeah?
X to the power positive 1.
Yes, x minus 5 raised to the power negative 1. Of course, it should be multiplied by that number, guys. Don't be very picky like this.
No, we mean shouldn't be positive.
Guys, listen to me, please. Listen to me. What I'm doing right now, I'm not getting into depths of the math. What I'm doing right now, whenever you see any distributed load starting from some location and extends all the way to the end of the beam, here is exactly what you're gonna do. You're gonna say it's okay. My Q of X is equal to, compare the number. This one is not unity. This one is 13 times the unity, which means I have to put 13. But this 13, is it positive or negative? According to the reference, this is positive. And then I'm going to say this one should be multiplied by x minus a, which is 5 in this case, raised up to the power 0. And now I know that I'm intending to come up with qx. My target is not qx. My target is what? V. Then you will end up by saying that my v is equal to the integration of that right part. You pull your 13 out of that one, of course, dx. And then you'll end up that you have positive 13. And the integration of x minus 5 raised to the power 0 dx, okay? Might be one of you will tell me, okay, be careful, man. X minus a raised to the power 0, regardless of the value of x, it should be 1, except in one case, which is 0 to the power 0. I'm not asking you to get into the details of the math, man. Once you come up to this step, just go rush directly to the table. What the table tells you about this integration? I'm not a mathematician. I'm telling you that the table is telling me, the mathematician is telling me, as long as this is a singular function, it should end up with this number, x minus a raised to the power 1. In other words, your integration here will become positive 13 times x minus 5 raised to the power 1. You got it? I'm sorry, I said negative 1 here. I know why you are confused now. Sorry, guys. So you see what I'm saying? You see the way I'm thinking?
Okay, yeah, now it's
clear. Doctor, now it's very clear.
Now it's very clear, alhamdulillah. Okay, so This if your case of if your uniform load with A was extended from A all the way to the end of the A to the end of the beam. But let me ask you a question, and whoever will answer that question, I'm going to give you him extra mark. I'm going to write it down here in the student list name. Okay. Now, guys, let's assume that I'm dealing with a case like this. Again, this will start from 5, no problem. I'm going to fix the density of the load. I'm going to make it 13, no problem. But here in that one, this number is 12. Okay. And the whole beam length is a, let's say, 15. Okay. Now, guys, I'm offering one extra mark to be added to your your marks regardless of what you did in the other assessments. Can you help me out to come up with the QX for this case?
Yes, doctor.
What's your name first?
Muhammad Al-Bahrani.
Just one moment, Muhammad. Muhammad Al-Bahrani.
I'm not sure, but I will
try. No, you have to be sure. Otherwise, I'm gonna put it with negative, man.
Okay, let's try.
Are you sure you'll take the risk?
Inshallah.
Okay. Just one moment. Muhammad Al-Bahrani, give me your ID, Muhammad, please.
472.
Now give me the full ID, please.
Yeah, is it to find the...
give me the full ID, full ID, your full ID, Muhammad, before you start.
381.
900 472.
472.
Thank you. Go ahead, man.
Yes.
I'm listening.
As we see here, we have the full length of the beam, and yes, we can do it by subtracting the this area. I mean, we find the DQ, the whole DQ, okay, as we did the previous one, then subtract it with that one. Subtracted with
Muhammad, yes. Just give me, it's like I'm in dictation class. عارف درس الإملة؟
أيوة.
Don't tell me the whole story. Give me the answer. Tell me that my QX is equal to, and then I'm going to follow up on you.
Oh, okay. 15. Is it 15? That one?
Which number? You mean this one?
Yeah.
No, this is 13 as down before, but I just make it for it. And this one number is 5.
Okay, 13. Number,
okay, 13. Positive or negative?
Positive 13.
Okay, positive 13.
Multiply by x minus a.
What's a, Muhammad? Tell me.
Yeah, a is the 12. Is it 3? The full numbers.
What's your A here in this case, man?
7.
7.
Yes.
Okay, I'm not going to discuss from where you got that number.
Yeah. Raise to sure? The power of
Muhammad, just one moment. Let me pay your attention to the numbers. This number is 5.
Okay.
This number is 12. This number is 15.
Okay. Then we 10, x minus 10.
Okay, Muhammad. Are you sure, yeah, or you need a help from a friend on the phone?
No, we don't استعانة بصديق.
Okay, thank you, Muhammad. You failed. You lost the money. Okay. Who else is willing to go that way? I'm not going to subtract anything from you. Sorry, Muhammad, I need to move on. Any other volunteer guys to solve this problem? Don't worry, I'm not gonna cut any mark from you guys, but I'm not gonna switch back to the chatting, guys. I'm sorry, because the mic has a problem. If I switch back to the chatting, I might lose our voice.
Doctor, I think.
Doctor, I think it's fine. Nothing mentioned in the role, in the formula here. Nothing mentioned. So it will be 5. Same thing.
Okay, so you'll continue from wherever Muhammad stopped. So I have to say x minus 5 here?
Yes, doctor, I think.
Okay, but you have to continue, man. And then what should we do? Raise it to the power negative 1?
Power negative 0.
Power 0, sorry. Yes, you're right. There is no negative 0, by the way, in our problem here. There is negative and positive 0. But this is not the case in the machine design. So now x minus 5 raised to the power 0. What else, Muhammad?
That's it, doctor. I think
that's it. If that's it, man, what is the difference between this case and the case before? The case before was something like this: starts from 5 and go all the way to the other support. Are you sure, man? That's it. I'm gonna cut mark from you, man. Be careful. Do you think that this case is exactly to that equal to that case? It's clear, guys, that there is a gap here. There is something empty here. Okay, I'm gonna stop here, guys, because it seems like nobody will get it.
Unfortunately, I think is a fun.
Who is speaking? First, tell me your name because I cannot see the list of the people.
تفضل رضا.
اوكي شكرا. توقع خالد. I think
Kyo is who is speaking now. رضا or Khaled?
This رضا.
رضا, okay, go ahead رضا. Tell me your story. Tell me.
I think Kyo of x is a function from 5 to 12 and Kyo x equals 13.
You see what I told Muhammad al-Bahrani at the beginning? I'm not here to think with you. I'm here just to write down whatever you're doing.
The final function. Qx equals 13. X minus 5. Dx. Power 0. Qx.
So the first term is okay.
Okay.
Do you see the monitor, Muhammad? Do you see the monitor?
Yeah, I see.
This part is okay. You agree?
I agree.
Now, what should I add? Should I add something or that's it?
Dx.
No, dx, this is later when you make the integration. We are not making integration. Now we are just thinking about how to create the
Qx. Multiply by the area.
Which area, man?
Area of the rectangular 13 multiplied by 7.
No.
Doctor, I think Q of x is only x minus 5, and when we want to find v, we'll do the integration. So what exactly you are trying to find, Q of x or v?
So you are telling me that the issue now is Q of x is okay. But when it comes to the integration, I have to play with the integration limits. Is that what you said?
No, I think Q of x is equal to x minus a, and if you want to have v, we'll do the integration of f of x.
No, please. Okay, can I stop here, guys? Because I need to give you the answer so I can move on. Now, guys.
I have an answer.
Khalas, please. Okay, I gave you a chance almost 10 minutes. Now, guys, this is the way I'm going to think about a problem like this. If this is the original case, I mean my load starts from 5 and ends at 15 according to the reference, because the reference here is telling you that this one is extended from A all the way to the end. And to change that case to be familiar with this one, what I'm gonna do is think in another way. What if I added, guys, another load from the bottom? Okay, let me clear it out here. Erase all ink. Here is your case, guys. Here is the case. This is 5. Okay, and this is 12 again, and this is the end, which is A15. Okay, Now, don't think about, didn't think about the problem until you think about what is equivalent to this case from the load point of view. Okay, first of all, I'm gonna make my case consistent with the first part of the problem, consistent with whatever is given here. In other words, I'm gonna assume that there is a distributed load started from 5, and this load go all the way to the end, which means that this distance from here to there is what, the 15, complete 15. Okay, now if I added another beam with the same character, same length, same diameter and everything, but when it comes to the load here, I'm gonna, after, when it comes to the 12, which is the end of that one, you see this one ends at 12, I'm gonna add another number, which is negative 13. Starting from 12 and ending up at 15. So if you combine this one and that one together, you will end up with what, guys? You will end up with that shape. Do you all agree about this or not?
Yes.
Okay. Again, I need to hear from everybody. Do you all agree that when you add up algebraic summation of this shape with that shape down there, you will end up that this is the final result? I mean, if this one plus this one, it will give you this one. Do you all agree about this?
Yes.
And that's it. What do I mean by that's it? Your life is easy now, man. Just think about every part separately. The QX of the first part is how much? I'm gonna say positive 13 times X minus 5 raised to the power 0. Okay? And then when it comes to that one, I know that it's acting from bottom to the top, which means that this should be negative 13 or minus 13. But be careful. This X this time will become X minus what? 12.
Minus 12, okay.
You got it, guys?
Yes, it's clear.
Is it clear now?
Yes, it's clear, doctor, but I have another question.
You have another question. What's your question?
Is to find Q or V?
Yes, sir. I'm coming to this point. But is it clear now how I formed the QX?
Yes.
Now, let's come up to the integration to come up with V. Very simple. In your V, you have two terms. Each term has its own integration. The first one will be 13 integration of X minus 5 raised to the power 0 dx. Okay. And the other one is equal to negative 13 integration of X minus 12 raised to the power again 0 dx. Again, I have to rush back to the table. What the table tells me about this? The table tells you whenever you see something like this, your answer should be X minus A raised to the power 1. In another terms, this one should be replaced with 13 times X minus what? What will be in the first case? 5. And in the second case, it will be minus 13 times what? Again, my integration tells me, the integration of that part tells me that I should end up with X minus A raised to the power. But A in the second case is how much, guys? 12. That's it. So you will end up that your V is equal to, you distribute, it will be 13X, okay, minus 13A, 13X minus 13X minus 13 times 5, minus 13X plus 13 times 12. You got my point, guys?
Yes, I think it's understood.
Yes, doctor.
Okay,
doctor.
Now, yes.
Is that different from my initial thought was to have the V from that QX would be 13 X minus 5 from 5 to 12. before putting the other uniformly distributed load. Isn't the final result will be the same if I have integral 13 x minus 5?
You mean that the first answer of I think Muhammad al-Bahrani, when he said just leave it x minus 5 and just play with the integration limits?
Yes.
No, it will not work, man, as you can see. In this case, you have x minus 5, and this one is x minus 12, which is completely different.
No, before putting the distributed load.
I'm sorry, I have to stop questions here. We are wasting our time.
Okay, in the application, we need to have examples, guys.
I need to cover the examples before I finish other parts, okay?
Okay.
So now, I'm going to go to this problem. Drive the loading and shear force and bending moment relation for the beam shown in figure. As you can see, guys, this case you have two concentrated loads. If it's two concentrated loads, I know how to deal with the situation here. Not only two concentrated, even the R's themselves, you will deal with them as if they are a concentrated load. So when you create this function, let me go to the solution. Okay. See, guys. We are dealing with the R as if it's one of these concentrated loads, because it's really concentrated load. But in this case, you said R1, okay? R1, remember, guys, why we put R1 as positive? If you go back to the table, you see the arrowhead is going where? Upward, which means that your R1 is consistent with the positive or the reference direction. So your R1 and R2, both of them will be added, plus. But for the 200 pound feet bound force and 100 pound force, both of them will be subtracted. Okay, if you are talking about the sign. And now, when you are talking about R1, you say this is the value of the force itself. And then we multiply by X minus A. What will be A in the first case, guys? What do you think about
zero.
A in the first
zero.
Case? Allah inawar alayk, zero. Raised to the whatever the power, you go to the table and you have to memorize, by the way, guys. This will not be given. This table is, you should memorize that table for the different cases, okay? So what you need to do is just to go, and this is a concentrated moment. This is a concentrated force. Of course, it doesn't matter if it's memorized or not, because you are away from me. Anyway, I'm going to give these forms to you, okay? So now, if you go to our business, this should be x minus 0 raised to the power a. Remember what was the case of the concentrated force? Raised to the power negative 1, right? So this would be raised to the power negative 1. So in this case, there is no need to write down the 0. Then you will end up that your first term is R1 times x raised to the power negative 1. Okay? Now, the next one is what? 200? Is it negative? Am I right or wrong?
Right.
Times x five. Minus how much? 4?
Raised
to the power negative 8. The third term is 100, negative 100, again times x minus a?
10.
10?
Yes, 10.
Okay, and then finally you said, okay, this is R2 multiplied by x minus how much?
20.
Raised to the negative 1. Let's compare this one with whatever we got on the next slide. Yes, sir. Here is exactly what we did. Alhamdulillah, we are okay. All the terms are okay. And then when it comes to the next, to the integration, see, guys, I was not caring about how this one will be integrated, because in the right situation, if you are talking about regular function, x to the power negative 1, it cannot be integrated, and it will be x to the negative 2. X to the negative 1, you add number, and then you'll be in trouble. You know why? Yeah, let's say that I'm integrating this one, x to the negative 1, dx, which is supposed to be, what will be the integration?
X to the power 0 divided by 0.
Power negative 1 plus 1, and then you divide by a, whatever you have from here. Am I right or wrong, guys?
Yes, doctor, you are right.
Then you'll end up by dividing by 0. If you divide anything by 0, you'll end up with what?
Plus or minus infinity.
Undefined.
Plus or minus infinity, but this is not the case. This is not the case. I'm thinking about singular function, which has another story. What are the whole story? This is not my business. The program tells me that once you find something like this, dx, then your answer will be x to the power 0, and that's it, guys.
Okay.
You got it?
Yes, understood.
Okay, again, for that term, what the table tells me, the table tells me that it will be x minus 4 raised to the power 0. Okay? And then x minus 10 raised to the power 0, and then x minus 20 raised to the power 0. Okay? Now, guys, if I'm going to this one, how if I'm trying the m, what will be the m? Another integration for the a, another integration for the terms of the v. So x to the power 0, the integration will give you x to the power 1. The integration of x minus 4 to the power 0, it will give you x minus 4 to the power 1. So be careful, guys, and please listen carefully. Don't try to mix up the terms until you finish up your whole business. يعني don't make distribution. Don't say it's okay. I'm going to simplify this one. If you are thinking about simplifying this one, you'll be in a trouble. You know why? Because anything raised to the power 0, it should be how much?
1.
1. But be careful. You did a mistake without feeling. You know why? Because one of the scenarios is to have a x equal to 4. And whenever you have x equal to 4, then you will end up with 0 raised to the power 0. What will be 0 to the power 0, guys?
Undefined.
Undefined. So please, don't do that mistake. I think I did that mistake before, a moment ago. Okay? Don't distribute the numbers on the arcs or parentheses until you finish up your whole business. You got my point?
Yes, doctor.
Okay. So now, guys, as you can see, your x is a variable. Your x is a variable. Your x is a variable. So what should I do in a situation like this? Very simple. You will come to the v and say it's okay. If I need v at a at certain location, وليكن مثلا x تساوي مثلا 2.5. Very simple. You go to each term and replace x with 2.5. Okay? So please don't ever, never distribute the forces on the A, on the balances. Keep it as it is until you come to the point where you distributed, you substituted this X, and then at this exact moment you can say it's okay, this becomes 2.5 times R1, and I already have R1 from the equilibrium, and this is X equal to 2.5 minus 4, then you'll end up with what? Negative 1.5 raised to the power 1 multiplied by 200 and so on. You got my point, guys? You got this one?
Yes, doctor.
This is why the in the textbook intentionally he did not put the regular parentheses. You know, the regular parentheses that we are dealing with is something like this. But if you look carefully in depth, this is not similar to that one. This looks like the sign of greater than or less than, which means that this one is allocated for a is allocated for the case of a singularity. Okay, ma'am?
Yes, doctor.
Okay. طيب. There is another trick here that you can do, guys, by which you can calculate R1 and R2. I mean the regular way in a problem like this. First of all, you go and apply the equilibrium condition. And after applying the equilibrium condition, you start your business by knowing of R1 and R2. This is a regular business. But what is the other way to calculate R1 and R2 without going through the first equilibrium or the hassle of the equilibrium? Because actually, be careful. When you say equilibrium, يعني for example, if I have something like this, and you have mix up between distributed loads and concentrated loads, there is no way to come up with R1 and R2 until you concentrate, replace each distributed load with the equivalent concentrated force. And you know, when it's a uniform, you concentrate it at the at the center, and it's equal to the area, the load density multiplied by that length. I mean, for this one. And for that one, you concentrated one third from the base. Remember this story from the correct material?
Yes.
And this is very time consuming. So what will be the replacement? How can I get R1 and R2 without applying the equilibrium? Here is exactly what you need to do. Look at these two equations, guys. You have the equation of V and the M. Okay? You have equation at V and A, V and M. When you apply, when you put X value less than zero, or when you put, sorry, when you put, you put X equal to zero, then you will end up that your V value and your M value is zero. Not equal to zero. See, guys, I mean the very first part before the zero. This is why they write it down zero negative. Okay? When you say zero negative, what does it mean, guys? It means that you are in the A. You are no longer in the beam. You are somewhere else in between, before the beam. You got my point, guys? When you say X equal to zero, raised to the power, raised to the negative, it means that you are somewhere here right before the beginning of the beam.
Yes.
Because the beginning of the beam is the physical zero. Okay? But when you say zero negative, means it's something virtual. It's you are no longer on the beam. So what will happen if I substituted with that X? It will tell you that your V in this case will become zero, and your moment in this case will become A. Will become zero, okay? And let's see how can we get it. See, guys, he said the reaction R1 and R2 can be found by taking a summation of moments and forces as usual. دي الطريقة اللي احنا قلناها, الإيكوليبريم. Or they can be found by noting that the shear force and bending moment must be zero everywhere except that range. And this means that equation 2, اللي هي بتاعت الV, which represents the V, should be equal zero at x slightly larger or slightly smaller than a than 20.
هو طول البيم يعني يا دكتور.
أيوة. يعني see guys, we have two scenarios here. Either our x equal to zero negative or x equal to 20
plus
positive. You see the meaning of this, of these two numbers when you write it down this way?
Yes, doctor.
Okay. So now, guys, what did he do? He just went to the equation, okay? And he decided to, if you go to this one, see, he decided to remove all these terms. This term, he removed that term, he removed that term, he removed that term, okay? Assuming what, guys, why he was able to remove all these terms? Because simply he substituted with x equal to what? Negative. Sorry, x equal to zero raised to the negative. So again, if you said zero raised to negative, it's no longer zero to the power zero, which is a known case. It's still a number which is known. But anyway, for any number other than zero, guys, if you raise it to the power zero, what will be your answer?
One.
عشان كده هو لما جاي عوض, this is the reason when he put x. He did not clearly said x equal to zero. Otherwise, he's telling us something wrong. So he decided to call it x negative. So again, if you substitute with x by zero negative, then this term is a becomes one, and this term also becomes one because you will end up with negative four to the zero, right? And this one becomes also negative 10 to the zero, which is also one. And this term becomes a negative 20 to the zero. In other words, guys, once you put x equal to zero negative, this means that you remove all the this kind of a parentheses. You got my point? And then you will end up with the V equation will be like this: R1 minus 200 minus 100 plus a R2. Equal to, I know that the V out of the shape is no longer there, which means zero. As you can see, guys, this is equation number one. How many unknowns do we have? We have R1 and R2.
Two.
Yes. Now we will go to the M and apply the same A, the same principle. I'm gonna replace each X with A, zero to the negative. Then you will end up with what? Zero raised to any power will be what, guys?
One.
There is zero raised to the power.
Zero,
right? So this term will be zero, which means that you eliminated that term. Okay, let me be sure from what I'm saying. No, actually, see, in the other case, because he will eliminate both. يعني انت لو عوضت بزيرو هتنتهي بان مش هتطلع عندك في معادلة فيها R1 و R2، صح ولا انا غلطان؟ In the second equation, if I decided to let me see what he did. I'm sorry, عشان ما قلتش حاجة إيه. R1 is X. Okay. Yeah. See guys, either way, what he did, he substituted with X equal to 20. خلاص. لما when he substituted with X equal to 20, here is exactly what he got. This number becomes 20. This number becomes 20 minus 4, which is 16. صح؟ This number was 20 minus 10, which is 10. And this number becomes 20 minus 20, which is a 0, which means that he eliminated the R.
Eliminate the R2.
Eliminated the R2. But what if I decided to substitute with X equal to 0? Let's see. If you decide to substitute with X equal to 0, then in this case, you will end up with this one. R1 times 0. Then you will eliminate R1 in the second, yes, in the first case. You got my point?
Yes.
But doctor,
and then you will end up with this one. 200 times what? Negative 4? Am I right or wrong?
Yes.
This is times, man. This is not X. عادي علامة المالتبليكيشن.
ايه.
تمام؟
Zero.
And then minus 100 times what?
Minus 10.
Exactly, negative 10. And then plus
R2.
R2
multiply by minus 20.
Multiply by minus 20. وده بالظبط اللي هو اللي عمله. ان هو هنا جاء بس عمل ايه؟ سوري هو ما عملش دي. هو عوض بالايه؟ He substituted with X equal to 20 guys. Okay? You see what I'm saying?
Will be.
خليني معلش عشان
بس دكتور رايت
الحته دي لقيت بيت كونفيوزنج. سي جايز ام جونا ليت مي اريس ايفرثينج هير. سي فيرست اوف اول ان ذا فيرست ايكويشن هي ديسايدد تو سبستيتوت اكس ايكوال تو نيجاتيف 0 0 نيجاتيف. اوكي ذن هي اند اب وذ ذات ايكويشن نو بروبلم وذ ذيس وان. اند ذن وين هي جوز تو ذا ام انفورشنتلي هي ديد نوت سبستيتوت وذ اكس ايكوال تو 0 نيجاتيف. What he did, he substituted with what? X equal to what? 20. Okay. So let's go with the second option, which is his option. He decided to put X equal to 20. Then in this case, your M, you know that M out of the beam, مش احنا قلنا لو هي بعد العشوائية, if it's greater than 20, then you are no longer on the beam. And yes, your both of V and M are zeros. So yes, in this case, your M will be zero, which is equal to, let's go to the equation. R1 times what? 20 raised to the power 1, right? Minus 200 times 16 raised to the power 1. Minus 100 times 10 raised to the power 1. And when it comes to the final term, it's what?
R2 multiplied by 0.
So the only unknown here in this case is your R1, as you can see, guys. If you go to his equation, here is exactly what he got, exactly what we did. Okay? So he ended up by calculating R1. Not only this, he take R1 and he plug it back into this equation. So R1 is known right now. Then the only unknown here in this equation would be R2. Okay, guys? I need you to try the other way. The other way is to keep substituting with X equal to 0, negative 1. So if you keep, if you substitute with, in the M with X equal to 0, negative, in this case, you will end up by eliminating the first term. And the only term that will exist in this picture will be R2. You got my point?
Yes.
And then compare the value of R1 and R2. Yes.
Will we be able to do this type or this method in an equation, doctor?
Yes, of course, man. By the way, guys, this way will save you almost 15 minutes. Believe me, guys, if you have a complicated equation like this, I mean complicated beam like this, has mix up of concentrated load and the uniformly distributed load like this, and something like this, believe me that just the equilibrium itself will take between 10 to 15 minutes. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, doctor.
So, if totally right. First of all, you will do your business assuming that both of R1 and R2 are given, and just put them as a symbols. Okay, R1 and R2. And then when you finalize your problem, I mean when you reach to these two steps, the form of the V and the form of the M, just remember that outside of the beam, there is no V, there is no M. In other words, practically speaking, when your X is equal to 0, negative, or your X is equal to 20, positive, in these both cases, your V is equal to M is equal to A, 0. You get it?
So, doctor, if we substitute 0 instead of 20, we should get the same answer, right?
You should get the same answer. Did you get another answer or what?
I'll try.
Okay, let's try. I'm not sure, but you have to get the same answer. Okay, the second one is A. We decided to get rid of R1, right?
All right.
Okay, so in this case, you will end up with negative 200 times what? X in this case will be what? 0. So it will be times negative 4 raised to the power 1. And then negative 100 times negative 10 raised to the power 1. Okay, because you are substituting X with 0, guys, remember. Okay, and this will be plus R2. Times negative 2a 200 equal to 0. Now let's see, this one is a, we can take 100 as common. Okay, let's say, okay, I'm gonna take
doctor,
yes,
R2 should be x minus 20, not 200, right?
Yes, I think.
Yes, thank you. Okay, now guys, I can say that this is negative times negative. You will end up with 800 and then plus 1000. Then your answer here will be 1800. Am I right? On the left side, positive. And if this one will go to the next side, it will become 20R2. And then you end up that your R2 is equal to 1800 divided by 20. Am I right or wrong?
Yes.
So 1800, then you'll end up with this zero will go with that zero, and then your R2 in this case should be 90. Equal to 90. Did he get 90? Yes. Yes, sir. واضح يا جماعة الكلام ده؟
Yes.
Yes, very clear. Thank you, doctor. Thank you.
Yeah, you are welcome. Now let's move to the A. Another example. Wow. Look at this example, man. This is what I meant. In this example, you have mixed up between two concentrated moments, two reactions. Okay. No, there is no reaction here, guys. You see, this problem, if the only way to accept this problem is to think about it this way, that this is a cantilever, which is fully supported from the left and has distributed load somewhere in the middle and has concentrated moments at the end. How did I know that this is a cantilevered beam, not a beam which is hinged?
Because it has moment.
How did I know this?
Because it has moment. There is moment.
Because there is what?
There is a moment.
No. See, man, don't tell me that I catch it from the name, because here it says a beam cantilevered. But let's assume that I did not never mention that this is a cantilevered beam. I just said a beam. By the way, guys, in the applied mechanics, I mean this branch of which you study machine design 1, machine design 2, structural mechanics, and all these classes, whenever you say just the word beam by itself, it means that it's supported from the two sides. And the only accepted scenario here for this beam is either the two sides are hinged, or two sides are fully supported, or one hinged and one fully supported. You got it? But actually, believe me, that when I said the only accepted scenario for this one to be cantilever, when you say cantilever, the beam means what? Means it's fixed from one side and free from the other side. Believe me, guys, that when I look at the picture, I quote that this one cannot be anything other than cantilever the beam. Not because I read down the statement of the problem. It's because of other reason. Can somebody tell me what is that reason?
There is no R2 at the end.
Because there is only one reaction on the left. There is no reaction on the right. But it's not supported on the right.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. See, guys, first of all, I looked at the two reactions. The only way to have R and the M, the only accepted scenario here is that this side should be fully supported. Okay? And yes, when I looked at the other side, see, the other side, it should be one of the two scenarios. Either this scenario, and in this case, this end should have both R and the M, okay? Or that scenario, which is a hinged, and the only accepted here, the only accepted reaction here is just the R. In other words, guys, in both cases, either with the first assumption or second assumption, you should have R. The only M the concentrated M only appears in the case of what? In the case of the fully supported. Okay? So once I see that there is no R here, then by default, blindly speaking, this part this end of the beam is free. It's not a supported, either fully supported or supported with a hinge. You got my point, guys?
Yes, Doctor.
But somebody might ask me from where you got this one. This is an external force, man. And I mean it, don't say it's not force, it's a moment. No, guys, there is difference between saying a force, because there is, sometimes you are saying forces. Forces, in general meaning, it means everything. It means force, it means the moment, it means torque. Okay? So when you hear I said that this is external force, it does not mean that I did a mistake, I said something wrong. No, it's a force, but it's in general force, in general situation. But if you need to say specifically what is there, it's external moment, not external force. Okay? ليه يا جماعة أنا بدقق على التعبيرات دي لأن هستخدمها كتير بعد كده فما حدش يقول لي أنت غلطان أو أنت بتتكلم في حاجات بيزكس بتغلط فيها لا خلاص so now what's your business somebody might tell me my first business is just to come to this load and just concentrated at the center to come up with equivalent force and then apply the equilibrium condition to calculate R1 and the M1 it's okay if you do this that's fine with me But you have to be sure that you will waste a lot of money and a lot of time. So what is the best way? The best way is to deal with the problem as if your M1 and the R1 are given from the beginning. You got my point? And then, after you finish up your business and come up with the final form of V and the M, then you can substitute with the conditions. What are the conditions? Out of the beam, when I say out of the beam, it means either x equal to 0 negative 1, 0 negative, or x equal to 200, in this case will be 10 inch plus.
Yes.
You got it? So yes. Now, guys, I'm not going to go through the whole, the solution in details. How much time left?
8 minutes.
لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Anyway. See, guys, here is my plan because we are moving very slow. Some of the parts of chapter 3, it's already there. Like what? Okay, let me finish this one first, and then I'm going to tell you what will happen with chapter 3. Okay? First of all, I'm going to build up the Q for QX. The QX here in this case should start with what? If we are starting with R1, Remember, guys, this R1 is consistent with the reference direction. So it will be R1 times X minus A. Remember, a in this case will be what?
Zero.
Zero, right? Raised to the power negative a?
One.
Negative one, right? And then plus, is it plus or minus? Now I'm going to deal with M1. Remember, guys, M1, the reference one is acting in the clockwise direction. Remember this?
Yes.
And it was unity. But here in this case, I don't know if it's unity or not. So I'm going to keep it as it is. So I'm going to consider M1 the symbol as if this is the, this is the, this is the magnitude itself. So I'm going to write it down this way. First of all, don't say plus. It should be a negative M1 times
x minus zero.
Zero, but this time is raised to which power?
Minus two.
Minus two. You have to go back to the table, okay? Now, remember the story of this one?
Yes.
This uniform load is not extended all the way to the end of the cantilever. So how can we deal with the problem like this? Alhamdulillah, we have the experience. See, guys, I spend a lot of time in some tricky stuff, but your life will be easy after that. So now, what I'm going to do is a case like this. First of all, I'm going to write down 20, which is the density of the load, times x minus...
Minus three.
Raised to the power, I forgot to be honest with you, let me go back to the table. Raised to the power what? Zero. You see this one? Zero. Okay.
Yes.
So it's raised to the power zero. That's it? No. Remember the trick? Minus 20. Yes. Times what? X minus what?
Minus seven.
Seven raised to the power zero. Alhamdulillah. Okay. Now, what is the very last thing that we need to do is to add up the concentrated moment, which is what?
The moment.
Negative or minus or positive? Minus or plus, guys?
Plus.
Minus.
Minus.
Counterclockwise.
Minus.
Yes, the reference is clockwise. Here you go. This is the reference, guys. Okay.
Mm-hmm. This is the reference. Okay.
Now, minus 240 times what? X minus 10. Okay, raised to the power negative a, negative 2. See, this is how I formulated the qx. What is the next step? The next step is to distribute the integration on these five terms, right? And now, if it comes to the integration, assuming, guys, that this becomes v, so this one should be r1 times what? Integration of x minus 0 raised to the negative 1 dx. Should I go ahead and get into the deep in mathematics? No. Just go back to the table. X minus 0 is x. Okay? Raised to the power negative 1. Okay. What did the book tells me? The book tells me that x minus a raised to the negative 1, the integration will be x minus a, which is a in our case here is 0. So you'll end up with x to the power 0. And again, guys, be careful. Don't think that you might, once you reach the x to the power 0, then you have the right to a to apply the rule. Anything raised to 0 is a is 0. No. We still have an odd case, which is 0 to the 0. So be careful. Don't make any distribution. Just leave everything as it is. This is why, guys, when you write down the equation, be careful. You have to stick to the same representation. When I write down the equation, I got it here in this one. See, guys, he's writing down this one as a. It's not regular arc or parenthesis, okay? It is that special one because this is a singular function. Masha Rajala?
Mashi.
Tight. Anyway, I'm not gonna get into the details of the integration. All the time, if you need to think about the integration, rush to the table, look at the final form, and plug it into the equation. Now, guys, this is a V form. If I need to move from V to M, what should I do? If I need to move from V to M, here is the answer, actually. You come to this
integrate.
One. Integrate, exactly. Don't distribute. Don't say, I'm going to say M1x, negative 1, and the R1, in case you have the values. No, leave it as it is. So the integration of x to the negative 1, which is x minus, remember, guys, don't get confused. This, always remember the general form. the integration of the general form of that singularity function is equal to x minus a. Again, put this arc like this and raise to the power a, zero. Otherwise, we'll be in a big trouble. If you are thinking the regular way, you said it's okay. It's x minus 1 plus 1 and then divided by 0. Then you will end up with a, with infinity. This is not the way of thinking. I'm keep repeating for this one because I know later somebody might forgot and then start getting into trouble once he comes to this step. Anyway, you ended up with these two forms, one for V and one for M. What is the left, what is the left step, guys? The left step is to apply this A, this rule. Both of V and the M are zeros in two case, two cases. Either X equal to
zero negative. Zero.
Negative
or 10 positive
or equal to 10 a 10 positive. Okay, 10 positive. Okay. And now, what did he do here? Actually, what did he do? He just substituted the first one, x negative, zero negative. Then he ended up with what? He ended up with what? This is zero, so zero to the negative zero is still zero. Okay. And this one is no, just one moment, guys. I think here he substituted with 10. 0 to the negative 1 is not 0. 0 to the negative 1 means infinity. I'm sorry. So what he did, he substituted with this one first. He replaced each x with 10. So 10 to the negative 1. Just one moment, guys, because I have something here in, is not right. The reaction are found by making x slightly larger than 10.
Doctor, I think he integrated here.
I'm sorry, M is going
just one moment, guys, because I'm confused. I think that the first equation that he substituted in was the moment equation, not the V equation. Yes, yes. See, guys, yes,
Doctor, I'm not sure, but I think M1 is located exactly at zero. It's not moving along the variable.
What did you say again?
M1 is localized at exactly zero. It's not changing along it. So I think it's...
M1 is located exactly at zero, and then what will happen?
It's not moving like a distributed...
No, guys, just one moment, please, because I need to figure out what did he do here. He said the reactions are found by making X slightly larger than 10. So he substituted X larger than 10, guys, okay? And... okay? Where both V and M are zeros in this region, okay? And if if we put here X and we raise it up to the power negative 1, you should end up with negative, okay, R1. Okay, this x equal to 10 to the negative 0 will give you 1, and this is 10, and this is 10, and then he said 10 minus 10 is equal to 0, yes, but this one it should be 10 here. This number, guys, is wrong. This number should be 10.
Yes, doctor. Yes.
Zero,
0.1
it will be.
Yes, it
10,
should be
0.1,
right?
Yes.
Okay. I think this is the only accepted scenario is to let, something wrong here, guys. Okay. So please try to put the you know exactly, guys, what will just the only way to know if this solution is right or wrong, we can solve the problem first using the equilibrium. We can use the equilibrium condition. Remember the equilibrium condition, summation of force, summation of moment. You got it? You see what I'm saying, guys? We can find, first of all, we can find the R1 and the M1 using the equilibrium condition and keep them aside and then go to his solution and compare the R1 and the M1 with what he gets. I think he did a mistake here. This one should be 0.1, guys. This value should be 0.1 because actually it will be 10 to the negative 1 is 1 over 10, which is 0.1. So there is a mistake here, guys. Please fix that mistake and calculate again the new numbers M1 and R1 and compare these two numbers M1 and R1 with the M1 and R1 calculated from the equilibrium and tell me which one is right and which one is wrong. You got my point?
Yes, there is a mistake in the book.
There is a mistake, alhamdulillah. So again, guys, I'll get back to the textbook. If you remember Muhammad Taha, I'm gonna remind you all the time. This textbook, that does not mean that he's telling you something coming, revelation. It's just any regular book written by any regular man. So we might see a lot of mistakes while we are working during this class, okay?
Okay, that's all.
So trust me then. Inshallah, I hope that you'll trust, get the trust.
Of course. Of course, doctor.
Okay. Now, guys, I think he already calculated the M1 and R1. After calculating the M1 and R1, you can go back and substitute with the values of M1 here and the values of R1 there. And then if I asked you to draw the shear force diagram, very simple. You will divide your beam into stations. Remember, guys, I'm sorry, this case, what is important for you is to calculate the stress, the shear force. Yani here, I'm going to pick up which location I'm going to substitute with x and x equal to 0. This is the first important location. The second important location, x equal to 3. Okay. The third important location is x equal to 7. You see what I'm doing, guys? And then the final location, x equal to a, x equal to 10. خلاص فهتلاحظ حاجة. This is actually from mechanics of material. From the first location all the way until you reach to the beginning of the distributed load, your shear value is constant. And once you get into the distributed load, the V, usually the V is greater than the A. The power of the V is one power above the A, the distributed load. Usually this uniform distributed load means that the power is zero. So when you represent the V, V should be represented as a ramp, okay? And again, guys, the very last part of your A shape does not have any V at all, according to the equation. What about the moment? Again, you go to the moment equation, and you substitute with different values of X, X equal to 0, X equal to 3, X equal, in, I mean this equation, guys, this one, okay? You substitute with x equal to 0, x equal to 3, x equal to 7, and then you end up by calculating moment here, the moment there. You know, guys, usually if your V is horizontal line, then your moment will be a ramp. And if your V is a ramp, then your moment will be a parabolic A shape. So what you need to do is just to calculate the M at the beginning and the end, and then by freehand, you connect these two together. معايا رجالة. And again, in this part, your V is zero. This means that your A, the very next step after the zero value is that your moment will be a uniform A, uniform moment. You should memorize all of this or recall all of this from mechanics of material. Are you following me, guys?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Now, let me tell you the whole story of that chapter, because actually this chapter is completely mechanics of material. But what I did actually, because there is difference. Have you ever heard, guys, about this table before, the singularity table?
No,
the mechanics of material? Eh?
No.
So now, here is exactly the plan of dealing with that chapter. In that chapter, guys, it tells you how to draw, how to represent the what's called stress element. What do I mean by stress element? Okay, let me close this one first. Save it. Continue. I'm gonna share with you the screen. Okay, just one moment. Share application. Okay. Can you see the hello? Can you see the PowerPoint now, guys?
Yes.
PowerPoint. Okay. So I'm gonna go quickly through these parts. Of course, what I'm gonna do, guys, I'm gonna upload all this lecture to the Blackboard. But I'm not gonna go through them during the class time because it's just a repetition from the mechanics of material. But what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna conduct one full lecture. I mean remember that we have office hours this coming Sunday. Don't we have office hours period yes. 4 and 5?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So yes. Whatever I uploaded to the Blackboard from that chapter, and I'm sure that this is repetition for mechanics for material, I'm not going to go through it during the regular time of the class. I will let you read it because this is just a review on mechanics of material. Okay. And if you have any questions, please, I need every one of you to prepare like the question number and the slide number. Tell me, okay, for example, this lecture is lecture 3.2. Then let's assume that you have some question somewhere here, for example, here in that place. Okay, you'll tell me, doctor, please, can we go to lecture 3.2, slide 4 or slide, and then we'll start our discussion like this. But no, I'm not going to go through like the same old material that you studied in the mechanics of material, guys, okay? So if I went through this lecture, tell me which part of this lecture you are not familiar with. Are you familiar with these two shapes, guys? This is what we call it stress element. And the stress element has two shapes, two-dimensional and three-dimensional. Are you familiar?
Yes, of
course. Please, guys, yes, I need you to be honest. Don't, if you forgot your mechanics material, this is not my business. But tell me the true story. Because we don't want to waste your time. This topic, I mean, this subject has a lot of subject to be covered. And unfortunately, chapter number three is completely repetition, exact repetition of mechanics of material. So I don't want to waste my time with chapter number three. But I will not eliminate it, of course. As I said, I'm going to upload all the lecture to the Blackboard. And I always arrange the lecture in a very good way such that it will be easy to make self-study. And let's assume that you forgot some part or some part was confusing a little bit from mechanics material. I'm going to repeat it again. Don't worry. Okay? But now I'm not going to fully cover these lectures during the regular time. You agree, guys, with that deal?
Okay.
Yes, doctor.
Okay. Now, I'm going to go through this one. This is the same stress element. And then there are two different ways to represent the stresses. There is some way which is called the Cartesian component, sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. And there are some other components like cylindrical component and polar components. I'm pretty sure that you hear these names in the dynamics. So whenever you represent any vector, guys, there are different coordinate systems. There is representation in the Cartesian coordinate. There is representation in the radial coordinate, cylindrical coordinate. There is representation in the polar coordinate. In our business, as a machine designer, we are only focusing on one coordinate system, which is the Cartesian coordinate. This is why you always hear about a sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. You will never hear from me that there is sigma r and sigma theta, as in the dynamics, okay? So now, we'll deal with the sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. And again, guys, I'm pretty sure that you are familiar with this sigma. This is a sigma which shows up on a plane making an angle phi. This is a the first term, second term, and a third term. And then out of these two equations, this is, of course, this is the equation of normal, of the normal stress on this inclined plane. And this is the shear stress on this inclined plane. What if I need to calculate the maximum normal and the maximum shear stress? There are something called the principal stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 2. And the only way to come up with sigma 1 and sigma 2 here, guys, is just to make a d sigma by d phi and substitute to 0. And again, d tau by d phi and substitute to a. And make it equal to 0. And then you end up with calculating the phis at which sigma max and tau max will take place. And then you will end up with these forms. Are you familiar with principal stress? We mentioned this one at the end of the third class. These are the two principal stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 2.
Yes.
Remember, guys?
We revise it in the next class.
Say it again?
We revise it and discuss what we didn't understand in the next office hours.
Okay, I'll postpone the discussion to the next office hours, but now I'm just trying to tell you that there is nothing new for the uploaded lectures. All what you need to do from the moment I upload these lectures until we meet inshallah on this coming Sunday, that you have to go through all these materials in case something that you did not digest it or you forgot it from mechanical material. Then inshallah we'll discuss it on this coming Sunday. This is what I'm trying to tell you. Sure. Is that okay with you?
Okay.
Anyway, I'm gonna stop the lecture here because it seems like it's getting.
في صوت يا جماعة؟
لا لا.
No, I can't hear him.
لا ما في صوت. لأن حتى الصورة راحت.
إيه.
يمكن الدكتور وقف.
Can you see my text? No, doctor, we cannot. Ah, yes, we can.